Hey guys, Sam Pardee here for ChannelFireball.com, and I'm going to be recording with Experimental Frenzy Affinity in Modern. This is a deck that was brought to my attention by Jarvis Yu, who I think played it. He played it at Grand Prix Oakland, went 11-4, so medium record, but he streamed it all week to great success. It's just a normal Affinity deck, but then it has three Experimental Frenzy as the top end, rather than anything like Thoughtcast. I think it's a pretty interesting idea. The deck has a low land count because it gets to play with Opal and Springleaf Drum, so obviously you're going to get to go pretty deep when you actually do Frenzy, and obviously the curve is very low as well. So yeah, I'm very interested to see how it goes, and let's get to some games. All right, here we are for round one. We get to go first. How's this hand look? This looks like a mulligan to me. I think we don't have quite enough lands. If we had a second land, like Welding Jar into Steel Overseer is pretty good. But I think this hand is both not explosive enough and not likely enough to actually cast our cards to be good. This hand, on the other hand, looks nice. We have turn one Steel Overseer, so hopefully that's good enough. Definitely do not need an additional Springleaf Drum to go with it. But we can go Ink Moth, Opal, Drum, Memnito, and play Steel Overseer. All right, well, if we get to untap with this, so if our opponent is not playing a Lightning Bolt deck, then things should be great. All right, I think things are going to be great. We're even kind of O-Stone resilient here. Oh, wow, Frenzy. So we can just play Frenzy this. Oh, no. One, two, three. Oh, no, we can play Frenzy this turn. Yeah, that's probably better than getting... We get in for two poison and get two counters, and get a counter on this Nexus. Yeah, I think playing Frenzy is probably better than that. Seems like potentially a lot of value. Alright, so this Opal gives us access to an additional counter on our Nexus, which is pretty good. I guess we might as well just do that now, given that we don't get to attack. This way we just get to F6 for their turn. So we're not going to get to play this Nexus, but, you know, the next land we draw we will get to play. Okay, our opponent is set up to have Tron relatively quickly. Let's go ahead and cast this. I think tapping these two. We might get to use this Nexus if we hit a land or an Opal on top, and use the Nexus in conjunction with plating, so that could be good. No, but we'll play a Vault Scourge, that's fine. So now we're not attacking with Nexus. And then we could play Signal Pest, or we can equip plating. So I think here we need to do a little bit of math and see what kind of a clock we can set up. If we play the Signal Pest and put counters on everything, and let's say our opponent plays a Wormcoil Engine, because I think that's the scenario we should prepare for. I think Karn will be relatively easy to beat, because they can only hit one thing. They probably have to take out the plating, and then they take three this turn, and then on the next turn it'll be four. This will be three, this will be two, so that's nine plus two from the Signal Pest is 11. So I guess that's not quite lethal, although maybe we have lethal poison. I haven't done the math there. The other option is to equip the Memnite, and then, oh, I was also not counting them playing Wormcoil in that equation, so, or if they play Wormcoil, then we kill them with Cranial Plating, so that's fine. So we can, so if they play Karn and hit Cranial Plating, and we play the Signal Pest, we don't have guaranteed lethal next turn. We could also hit a land, I suppose, if we play the Pest. Yeah, that actually sways it enough. The fact that we can play a land off the top just means that playing the Pest is probably a good deal, and turns out there was a land there. And now I think playing the other Pest is even better, because for the same reason, now we can easily beat Wormcoil, we can easily beat Karn with two Pests. So yeah, that actually worked out really well. Like, I should have just done that. Like, I don't think it was actually even close, thinking about the fact that we get a land drop potentially. Yeah, this is pretty good. Frenzy drew us one, two, or I guess we drew this Nexus that we didn't get to play, so Frenzy didn't draw us quite as many cards, but it drew us a lot of cards. Okay, and there's a Worm Coil, which, yeah, we're going to have absolutely no problem with, because we can just animate a Nexus and crunch in with it. I'm actually going to animate the Nexuses now, because that way I don't accidentally use this Summoning Sick one. That's my only concern there. Equip here to play around Gutshot, I guess. Activate and attack for like a trillion poison. We have almost 20 damage in poison, I think. This is going to be, you know, it's going to way more than enough. All right, so an easy game one. So for Tron, we definitely want Alpine Moon. Not really sure what else we actually want. And I think we can shave on Galvanic Blast is probably our worst card. So I'm going to cut all of those, I guess. And I'm guessing Spell Pierce is okay. O-Stone seems like a big concern. So yeah, Ancient Grudge also seems fine. So this maintains the same number of non-artifacts in our deck. I'm not sure if Spell Pierce or Grudge is better, but I think Spell Pierce probably is. Anyway, let's give this a try. All right, here we are for game two. We're on the draw. This hand is pretty medium. I don't think... If they have a way to interact with Steel Overseer, which it seems likely that they will, they get to bring in a lot of cards, then I think this hand just doesn't do enough, so I'm going to mulligan it. This one looks fine. Definitely do want a land. We might as well play everything here because we have a Signal Pest to pump it all up. Okay, so they have turn three Tron all rolled up, which means we have to make a decision about... I guess we should probably just play Overseer because it gives us the most potential damage. Although, you know, if they have turn three Tron and then follow it up with just about anything good, I think it's going to be pretty tough for us to win. We had a non-Mox Opal draw. Going to be an Oblivion Stone. No, a star. Okay. Star and a Spatial Contortion. Well, that's no big deal. I mean, it's not great for us, but it could be a lot worse. They're going to play Stirrings for an Ulamog, which means if they have... All right, and they have Ulamog coming down next turn, so that means we have to get Ravager into play, and ideally we draw a land so that we can load up this Blink Moth with the Ravager if we need to. But we'll see. We did not. So I think we still need to play Ravager. We still need to make sure that we get that value, depending on what they target with Ulamog. They might just go after our lands. I think that would be a pretty reasonable line. But obviously there's nothing we can do about that. It's just is what it is. Okay, they're going after Signal Pest and Ravager. So I think we should just eat and then probably eat Memnite as well and make a 3-power Ornithopter and, you know, cross our fingers that that somehow crosses the finish line, although it seems exceedingly unlikely. Maybe if we draw like a Darksteel Citadel here, we can play Plating, suit it up and hit for 6, and then I guess we'd technically have lethal with that next turn if our opponent just has like all green cards that they can't play or something. So that seems like our best out. Because we can play Steel Overseer and animate Blink Moth to get it up to 8. So I mean, this gives us a realistic chance at winning, not super likely. Okay, well, that turns out off the out of them having all green cards in hand. Now they can, you know, play any Nature's Claims or whatnot. Okay. Yeah, O-Stone is unfortunately going to be good enough here. We're going to get milled for 20 and then die, I think. And they got an Alpine Moon. Yeah, I don't know what we can draw, because obviously we just lose the Ornithopter and the Cranial Plating here. But that still seems like plenty. I guess maybe they won't blow it, but I think they will, just because they don't want to. You don't want to get punked out by Galvanic Blast here once you've done, you know, once you've come this far. So I guess we'll play Vault Scourge, Steel Overseer, and, you know, cross our fingers that somehow they live. Well, somehow they don't have another O-Stone, and then we have to chump, and then maybe we draw, you know, really, really well from there. But I'm not very optimistic. In fact, I think we have no outs. Yeah, actually, now that I think about it, I don't even know what we could draw. I'm just going to concede. Alright, so for game number 3, I think actually Grudge is going to be better than Spell Pierce. It seems more likely to me that we'll catch an Expedition map or something on turn 2 after tapping out on turn 1 than that we'll actually get to Spell Pierce it. And I really don't want to bring in more non-artifacts than that. I think that's about the right number. Also, Ancient Grudge is castable off the mountain. It's not a huge deal, but we do get one extra source for it, so it is something. Alright, let's give this a try. Alright, here we are for game 3. We get to go first. This hand is not amazing, but I think it's a keep. Because we have Alpine Moon in addition to, you know, the usual suspects, I think this is actually pretty good. We obviously don't have a way to cast Alpine Moon just yet, but we have a decent number of sources, and the hand is not bad in and of itself either. All right, I'll start with Steel Overseer. That's a pretty good draw. Okay, our opponent has turn 3 Tron ready to go yet again. So I'd love to see, not that. I was going to say something that that lets us survive turn 3 Tron. Some kind of colored mana source, ideally. But we'll do the best with what we have available. We are putting on some pretty real pressure. We can come kind of close to killing next turn, I think. is 7 mana by them. A Walking Ballista for 3. It's kind of what it's looking like. Alright, that's definitely good. But also beatable. I assume they're going to kill our Steel Overseer here. And then we'll... I think we should just sack it to Ravager. I think it's pretty unlikely that they can charge up the Ballista again in a way that is particularly meaningful. So sacking the Ravager to kill the Ballista, which is what would happen here. Because they would just sack Ballista to ping Overseer again if we tried to move counters from Ravager onto Steel Overseer. Is not that big a deal. So I think we should just make this play. Would still love to see a red source. That would be fantastic. Mox Opal would be our best draw. Another Overseer. Okay, that doesn't do much. So now we can plating up the Ornithopter and hit for a bunch. We lose pretty hard to Oathstone if we do that. Our other option is to play Ravager. And then we get to leave up Blink Moth, which we can move all of the counters onto if we need to. That's not a bad option, but I think it's going to be hard for us to also beat Oathstone here anyway. Like, we're only hitting for one, probably. Maybe four if we do that. I guess maybe we can sack the Ravager right away and hit for a little bit more. But it seems like it's going to be a 3-turn clock, which is just not going to be fast enough. So I think we should just go with the plating line. Because plating is going to be worth +5/+5. So we'll hit for 6 this turn, and they'll probably chump Ravager. And then next turn, we hit for at least 9, probably more. Yeah, I think I like this best. Nine mana, what's that going to be? This is going to be another Ballista for 3? That's kind of what it's looking like. Okay, I think we actually are going to be able to beat this using some Ravager tricks. We'll see. Oh. Well, that's disappointing. I guess. So if I sack my Ravager, it goes really badly, so we have to just sack the Ornithopter. Yeah, that's tough. That's unfortunate. Oh, they're trying to kill the Ravager now. Well, that's not going to work, because we have Darksteel Citadels we can sacrifice here. And will. I think we'll sack Citadel and then sack Plating to keep our Ravager alive here, if they go for another ping. Did we just win? We're going to end up with a 6-6, so we're just a tiny bit short. We can get to... I can count us up to 9, so if we draw a land, we win. Does Vault Scourge do it? I don't think so. Still can only get to 9, I believe. I think in that case, we should just play Vault Scourge and pass. Or, well, obviously we're going to hit for 6. This way... This way, I think we can potentially beat... Well, we're still in really bad shape to Ulamog. If we hit with both and just put them to 2... I guess that's no different than just playing this other Ravager. And then if they Ulamog, they kill both of our things. The problem is if we play Vault Scourge and just hit for 6, and then they play Ulamog, then they hit our Blink Moth and our Vault Scourge, and then we don't have a flyer left over, so we can't actually get through Ulamog. And it's pretty unlikely they have O-Stone. I think the best play here is to just hit with both. If we play the other Ravager and sack it, and then they have Ulamog, then they take out our Ravager and Nexus, and we're in the same place as if we just hit with Nexus and Ravager, only we are down a Ravager in our hand. So that doesn't sound very valuable. Yeah, I think I've talked myself into just hitting with both. That sounds best. We could obviously throw in the Darksteel Citadel for an additional damage, but that just doesn't seem worth it. I think having a way to animate Blink Moth is better. It's too bad we didn't draw land that turn. That would have been sweet. A sweet way to win. All right, they have 10 mana. Okay, that's not an Ulamog. And they've played their land already this turn, so they can't have Ghost Quarter. So that means they have to have something that deals with Blink Moth and also a way to block Ravager. Karn is not going to cut it unless they also have Spatial Contortion. So hopefully that doesn't happen. That would be a big bummer. Okay, there's Karn down. Yeah, Ravager goes away. All right, well, we still can't cast Alpine Moon, which would let us beat Spatial Contortion, potentially. Obviously, we're still going to go for it. What other option do we have? That's really unfortunate. No, they didn't have it. All right, they were just bluffing it. Well, we had a very, very good game one and then managed to, squeak across the finish line here. But we beat turn 3 Tron this game and, turn 3 Tron with a decent follow-up. So that was pretty impressive. We'll be back for round number 2. All right, here we are for round 2. We get to go first. This hand looks like a pretty easy mulligan. Unfortunately, a full house, not so good. Yeah, this hand looks okay, actually. It's not amazing or anything, but we have a potential turn 3 frenzy, and, plating is really good. I mean, yeah, this looks okay. Yeah, this definitely looks like a keeper to me. Welding Jar. We're on the play. I think Welding Jar is below the bar. It does let our Ornithopter hit for 1 more starting on turn 1, or on turn 2. But that's good, but not... I think we can do better. I think basically any creature is going to be better here. I'm going to play out the Opal because I think it is... If we get Inquisitioned, I don't want to lose it. I don't want to give them the choice, basically. Obviously, if we get Thoughtseized, I think we're most likely to lose Experimental Frenzy. But if we get exactly Inquisitioned, I think having the option might be important. Oh, okay. Not the Faithless Looting deck I was exactly expecting, but a Faithless Looting deck nonetheless. I think... So the option here is we can plating up and hit for 3, Or we can just play drum and equip plating. And I think that's actually better. Because that sets us up much better to cast and perhaps use Experimental Frenzy next turn. And our hand is not that explosive. We don't have that much damage. So I think getting us set up to do that is probably going to be better. I wonder if we're dead if they just return Borborygmos, actually. I think it's pretty hard. Probably not. They'd have to have a lot of lands. Oh, wow. Nothing played this turn. All right, that was a good draw. We get to play Frenzy now. And we do not get to play that Ravager, but we'll hit for four. All right. We are seeing the Borborygmos get at us. Does it mill the other cards? Okay, so they get to mill for three, and hopefully, you know, they don't have five lands left. They didn't get any lands there, and they also didn't mill any relevant creatures. So that's definitely good news for us. I'm guessing they're just going to throw a land at Ornithopter and call it a day. Actually, no. What am I saying? They very, very likely don't have any lands in their hand because of the way that this played out. It'd be very surprising if they had lands because they missed their second land drop. Oh, okay. Well, so they intentionally missed their second land drop. That's an interesting strategy. I don't know enough about this deck to really know if that's good or bad, but it's certainly interesting. So we'll Signal Pest, we'll get Vault Scourge involved. That's the end of the line for that. Let's go ahead and suit up old Blinky, equip. And we're going to end with the Vault Scourge equipped, I think, after hitting for seven here. Might make us a little harder to kill. All right. Well, if the best they can do this turn is Flashback Faithless Looting, I really don't think that's going to be good enough. They'd have to have, like, double Spirit Guide, Manamorphose, Goryeo's Vengeance, along with discarding a good fatty. It looks like that is not happening, so I think we're going to get this one. I think we should tap this way. Maybe that's wrong. No, maybe we should tap Blink Moth and Ink Moth, and then that way we can move Cranial Plating if we need to, so they have to have like double Slaughter Pact to get through it. Alright, that sounds reasonable. Well, we got to draw a lot of bonus cards with Experimental Frenzy. That card does not mess around once it gets into play. All right. So, for sideboarding, Rest in Peace seems good. Spell Pierce seems good. Steel Overseer seems kind of slow to me, given how I expect the games to play out. So I think those are going to be the cuts, although Galvanic Blast also doesn't do anything in particular, just speeds up the clock a little bit. So maybe like a 2-2 split, just to maintain our high artifact count. I think that's reasonable. We could bring in Dispatch instead of Galvanic Blast also, which sometimes will do something, but I think most of the time just won't. Maybe it's fine. No, I think They both basically deny our opponent a card draw with what's his name? With Gristlebrand in play. Yeah, I think this is probably the right way to have this. Yeah, let's give this a try. Oh, I guess actually we could take out Frenzy. Maybe I should have cut Frenzy. Yeah, who knows? I'll try that. Yeah, actually that sounds like the right thing to do. I think the games just aren't going to last that long. All right. I'm switching to this where we board out Frenzy. I think the games are probably just not going to be that long, so not having Frenzy in the deck is probably the right thing to do. Because we're just trying to win very quickly. They don't have a ton of disruption. We don't have a ton of disruption. All right, here we are for game number two. We're on the draw. And this hand is incredibly fast. It doesn't have any disruption, but it has turn one Steel Overseer. And, you know, I think we are just pretty much obligated to keep hands like that. Hope that we run up against our opponent's fail rate, or that they're just a little slow. Okay, we could actually play turn one Ravager instead if we want. It's definitely better against, like, a Pyroclasm type effect. If we play turn one Overseer, can we kill on turn two with an Ink Moth? I think we actually might be able to. Let's see, we get Animate, and then we add a counter, so that's two damage from that, two from Ravager is 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Or no, we don't have 10 because we don't have... we don't get to animate the Blink Moth, because we only have exactly 4 mana, which is enough to play Ravager and animate Ink Moth. So if we draw a 0, it is enough. It's not that likely. If we just play the Ravager here, what's our clock look like? It's not going to be that fast. Yeah, I think we just have to play the Steel Overseer. Definitely worth thinking through, though. All right, we got to untap. Oh, there we go. All right, that's 10. I can do that math. I think we're just going to go for it. A turn 2 kill is just too appealing to pass up. Sick. All right, that's awesome. Turn 2 kill, not bad. Pretty easy. We'll be back for round number 3. And look, they had Faithless Looting, Vengeance, Emrakul, so we had to pull off the turn 2. That's awesome. We'll be back for round 3. All right, here we are for round number 3. We're on the draw, and I think this hand is good enough. It's not amazing. But if Steel Overseer lives, it will be quite good. And we have enough to do on turn one that I think it's worth keeping. If we draw, like, an Opal, then obviously, I guess Opal makes most Affinity hands go from being, you know, merely good to being insane. And, I think this is good enough. All right, Cranial Plating is a great turn one draw. Means we'll have, you know, we have 2 payoffs now, basically. So even if Steel Overseer doesn't make it, we have another thing to do with our mana. Okay, not totally sure what we're playing against, but Not a big deal. We could leave up Galvanic Blast for Smuggler's Copter, but that just seems much worse than getting Steel Overseer into play. Oh, I think our opponent accidentally passed the turn there. I couldn't quite tell. It seemed like there was a bit of a stutter. Anyway, we're just going to go as hard as possible. Yeah. Pretty tough if we get to untap with Steel Overseer for them to win, so that makes sense. Didn't really see enough of what was going on, but I'm going to preemptively go ahead and bring in a couple of wear tears. They both have white mana in their deck, which means, you know, probably have access to Stony Silence. And also we saw Smuggler's Copter, so even the worst case scenario, we can just use wear on that. As for what to cut, I'm guessing Galvanic Blast is good. Like, I don't really know what's in our opponent's deck. I'm guessing it's a Soul Sisters type situation with Smuggler's Copter. So like Norn the Wary, all the different Soul Warden effects, things of that nature. I really don't know what is not good against them. Probably Memnite is not amazing if they have a bunch of Soul Wardens. Although I'm pretty loath to cut... Yeah, Galvanic Blast is probably just not that good. I'm really loath to cut Memnites to bring in other colored cards. I think that'll just make our deck too bad. And I don't know if Etch Champion is good or not. I don't want to go down to zero Galvanic Blast, I think. And I'm a little scared... Oh, I should probably bring in Aether Grid as well, actually. That card seems great. Yeah, I'm going to cut all the Galvanic Blast and bring in Aether Grid. All right, this looks satisfactory to me. Let's give it a try. All right, here we are for game number two. We're on the draw. Sand is completely cold to Stony Silence, and our opponent kept immediately. But we can't just mulligan to Wear Tear. I'll try it. I don't know. Could work. If they stumble a little bit in getting the Stony into play. I do think it's very likely our opponent has Stony Silence in their hand. Okay. Well, Spire at least gives us an out if they Stony us. I suppose it's better to play Vault Scourge here, actually. They both add the same amount of power, and Vault Scourge has lifelink, so better to get that one down first. Okay, no problemo. Okay, that is not a problem. I do not mind that at all. I'm just going to play plating. We could obviously have just played Signal Pest instead, but I think spending all of our mana that turn is more valuable. Looks like we might end up constrained in some ways. Okay. That doesn't really do anything that I can think of. So we can go Pest, and then just equip plating here, I suppose. And I guess we might as well animate the Nexus for an extra damage. Kind of unfortunate to draw the Mountain. Actually, I probably should not have played it. Just because we don't really want to show our opponent that we have that. Because that means now their Ghost Quarter is just a strip mine. But what's done is done, so hopefully we don't get too punished for it. Next turn we can go plating equip on Signal Pest. I don't think we want our current plating to end up on Signal Pest, because if they're going to kill one of our creatures, I think we would rather have it be the Ornithopter. But next turn I'm going to have a plating on both. Yeah, no blocks on the first strike, crew. Okay, so now we have also a frenzy to follow up with later. But for the time being, I think just getting this double plating situation going is probably going to be pretty good. And when they go to kill, Signal Pest will animate Blink Moth instead. Which I suppose does open us up to Ghost Quarter, but what can you do? And this is also lethal if they don't have a removal spell, but I suspect our opponent probably does have a removal spell. They passed with all their mana up, and they kept a 7, so it seems likely that they have something. Oh, they're going after Ornithopter. Okay. Well, it's all the same, really. I thought they would kill the Signal Pest just because I think it's a slightly better creature, but maybe they have something like Gutshot that can only hit Signal Pest. Okay, so we got them down to 6. If they don't have an additional removal spell or a flyer, they're dead. And if their flyer causes them to have to tap their Ghost Quarter, they're also dead. Alright, we go to 6. Slaughter the Strong. Okay, so I guess they get to keep one thing and we get to keep nothing, but we do get to play Experimental Frenzy now. I guess we should leave this Blink Moth, this not summoning sync Blink Moth available. We might be able to force their hand on the Ghost Quarter if we hit, you know, a zero cost creature and a Mox Opal or something like that. Nope, no such luck. But we are going to have, well, I guess we're a land short of playing, of activating double Blink Moth next turn and having, and being able to equip them both. Because we're not going to be able to play the Darksteel Citadel from our hand. Okay, what does this do? Activates an artifact creature to land on the battlefield that isn't a mana ability. Okay, so we're going to be at 3. That might actually be good enough here. Interesting. And they can rebuy Thalia if they want to. Okay. Well, this was a variety of cards I did not expect to face. I will say that. Yeah, I guess we should just play the Opal. It's a free roll, even though it doesn't add mana. So yeah, we can activate a Blink Moth and die. Oh, this puts it back tapped. I didn't even realize it puts it back attacking. Yeah, we just have nothing we can even do. All right, Harsh Mentor, I guess that is. So, still don't know if they have, Stony, but Galvanic Blast does seem like it's actually pretty good. I think I'm going to cut the Aether Grids. I kind of was expecting some one health things. Yeah, I still want to leave in Wear Tear just as a hedge. Although, I don't know. Galvanic Blast does just seem like maybe it's really good against what our opponent is up to. Like, maybe we're just supposed to not sideboard and resubmit. I think that's actually what I'm going to do. If we get stonied, we get stonied, but let's give this a try. I think this might be our best chance to win. All right, here we are for game three. We get to go first. This hand looks great. Definitely a keeper. I don't know if I need to play Opal. It wouldn't astonish me if our opponent had Simeon's Spirit Guide, so that is the reason I want to do that. Okay. So now Opal's online, so we can play Overseer plus Plating this turn, or just Signal Pest, Overseer. I think probably Overseer Signal Pest is better because we can play and equip the Plating next turn. This is definitely slightly worse against Stony Silence because we could have the Plating already equipped if we wanted to in the other world, but I think that ship has sailed, and I think Stony Silence, like, it's not like it would be insane. They just have a Judge's Familiar they can block with it to trade off for the Signal Pest anyway, if that's what they have. All right, that is pathed. There's another familiar face. Judge's Familiars are actually pretty annoying. All right, we can Galvanic Blast one, and then hit with a Plating'd up Signal Pest. I think that's what we should do. We could also Plating up an Ink Moth Nexus. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So it'd be not really enough poison. Right, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So it'd be 7 poison. That does make future nexuses really scary. Whereas the Signal Pest is just damage. Yeah, actually, I'm kind of on board with the nexus hit. It forces our opponent to respect it in the future. Could really go for a Frenzy here also, obviously. That would just be fantastic. Yeah, actually, I like doing this because also this way, next turn, if we suit up the Signal Pest and attack with both Signal Pest and Nexus, it's kind of a tough choice for our opponent about which one to block. All right, the Harsh Mentor is back. I guess now they have Ghost Quarter, so it's not that tough. Okay. So I think it's worth stone raining our opponent here to do this. I guess we should play the Vault Scourge first, because then we get to use it with Drum. Because we do actually have a lot of things to spend our mana on here. So we're going to take two. They're also going to take two, because I assume they're going to Ghost Quarter this. Oh, I should have probably brought in Etched Champion as well. I think that's a mistake. I kind of forgot to reevaluate my initial suspicion of what our opponent's deck was in the context of what cards we actually wanted to have in. Oh, I didn't realize Harsh Mentor was opponent only. For some reason, I thought it was symmetrical. Okay, well, that makes me feel silly for saying that about them taking all that damage, but I guess that did not happen. If they don't block Signal Pest, I think I will not move plating. But now I want to, because I want to, if we draw an expensive card next turn, I want to be able to use it. Harsh Mentor has been pretty decent. Dealt us 6 damage there. It's not bad at all. Hopefully they're out of removal and we can just ride a nice lifelinking Vault Scourge to victory. Alright, Smuggler's Copter's in there, which can trade for Vault Scourge. But we have a Steel Overseer to follow up with. I'm fine trading here, I think. Although, yeah, every turn we don't trade, they have to just leave up. Yeah, I think it's actually probably better to not trade. If it causes them to not be able to attack, that's kind of valuable. And the Vault Scourge will get bigger over time. We also might be able to use the ability of Cranial Plating to move it. It is a bit problematic if they draw a removal, but given that we have another creature that they could use the removal on, then that's fine. Alright, here's some stuff. I guess if they attack with Smuggler's Copter, are we supposed to block it? Don't really know. Alright, another Vault Scourge is definitely a welcome addition to the team. I'm not going to take 4 just to put counters on our guys, so that's why I'm not even bothering to play this one pre-combat. I want to see what they do. I will take 4 to equip the other Vault Scourge, of course, because we're just going to have plenty of life. One option for them, of course, would be to play this to block with Selfless Spirit and then sacrifice it. And then we wouldn't gain any life. Goblin Crater Maker. Talk about a card I did not expect to see showing up in a modern deck. Alright, well, we get to go back up to a nice, healthy life total. And then slam Vault Scourge and equip a plating to it. I guess, yeah, I probably messed up by not playing this Vault Scourge pre-combat, because I do kind of now want to double Steel Overseer to get Vault Scourge out of range of these 2/2s. So yeah, that was probably bad. Even though it does obviously cost 8 life to do that twice. Alright. Happy to just see a land drawn over there. Ooh, a Ravager. Oh shoot, I forgot to activate. Ay, ay, ay. That was silly. All right, well, we're sending in this Vault Scourge, and we'll trade it for Selfless Spirit if that's what's going to happen, and that's fine. Another 7 life in the bank definitely would never hurt. Yeah, I should have played the Ravager pre-combat. This was a big mistake, obviously. Because I definitely, you know, we could gain more than 7 life that way. But we are here. We are where we are now, so what can you do? Play Ravager. Yeah, and it also just would have been an extra life from the Vault Scourge. Yeah, that was just a whole comedy of errors there. Not my best work. We'll go ahead and equip. And this time I will activate the Steel Overseer end of turn, I promise. Alright, another land for our opponent. And now the Ravager is going to get to attack into the Harsh Mentors. And they can't really block. Ooh, nice. Alright. That's very good. Now we can Galvanic Blast away one of them and take a lot less damage per activation of things. I didn't really want to use Galvanic Blast there. I didn't want to waste it. Okay. Alicia is actually pretty scary. Well, not really, because it has to attack. Yeah, never mind. It's not that scary. I guess we just have lethal next turn. Or we can force a double chump. Yeah, we can force a double chump. No. Is that true? All right, Galvanic Blast, Alicia. And then attack with both creatures. And activate Steel Overseer, so it's up to 3. And Ravager's up to 9. I guess that's not quite lethal. It does require one chump block. So I think that's probably the line then. And then also any artifact is lethal here. Because then we have, well, any artifact will force the double chump. Yeah, even you, little Memnite, even you will do. Because if they don't chump both, we just, you know, send plating on over to Steel Overseer. Oh, actually, we had lethal anyway, because we can sack the Ravager as well. Yeah. Okay. Well. move over plating, and we survived. I don't think I played those last couple turns very well, but just barely got over the finish line with a very surprising matchup and a surprisingly scary one at that. Yeah. All right, we will be back for round number 4. All right, here we are for round 4, and we get to go first. Yeah, this hand looks good enough. And while we're going first, let me tell you about ChannelFireball.com's deals. You can pre-order Ravnica Allegiance for a while until it releases on January 25th, so be sure to check that out at ChannelFireball.com. We're going to lead with turn 1 Vault Scourge because Signal Pest doesn't actually get to deal damage on turn 1, whereas Vault Scourge will. Looks like our opponent is on Dredge, probably? Question mark? Yeah, probably Dredge. I have no idea how the Dredge matchup is. Seems like it would be okay. We have some Rest in Pieces and whatnot that are kind of good, and as long as we don't get conflagrated too hard, I think we should be in good shape. Definitely jamming Overseer. That was a really good draw. With Welding Jar backup, I think it's really hard for them to remove Overseer and still continue to advance what they're doing. All right, so they dredged into... I'm going to pull up their graveyard and make it a little more visible for all y'all at home. They dredged into... They discarded a Prized Amalgam to the Faithless and then dredged into a Blood Ghast, which is going to get back that Prized Amalgam. So we'll see how much they can do this turn, because they're not going to get too many more turns after this. Do they have a Cathartic Reunion? It looks like they do. So they're going to get to go pretty broken. They have their best possible opening of Faithless into Cathartic Reunion. But you know, we'll see what we can do. All right, they got one chill and a bunch of stuff, a couple of Narcomoebas. They're gonna get three Prized Amalgams, so they add up. This is a pretty darn good draw. Don't exactly know what our best course of action is to actually beat it. I guess we'll play Signal Pest, Ravager, because what else are we going to do? And then are we supposed to attack with Vault Scourge here, or do we do some, like, blocking and make a giant lifelink guy that's supposed to let us survive? Either way, we should activate Seal Overseer now because of the presence of Dark Blast. Although they don't actually have a black mana source to cast it right now. They definitely did dredge it back, I'm pretty sure. Yeah, they dredged Stinkweed Imp, Dark Blast. So they for sure can do that. So yeah, we could block with Ravager, make like a 5/5 Vault Scourge, which also blocks something. That sounds pretty weak though. Kind of think we're supposed to go on the warpath. I don't really know how we win otherwise. I guess we have to like grind through the Narcomoeba army. We're definitely doing this now. And then yeah, we're just deciding if we should attack with this Vault Scourge or not. I guess we should. I guess the most likely way for us to win is to eventually accumulate enough creatures that are big enough that we can avoid dying to the beats. Alright, they hit a conflagrate and have 7 cards in hand, so that is bad. Everything about how this game has gone is bad, actually. We lost the die roll. Oh no, we didn't even lose the die roll. They won the die roll. Or we won the die roll. Jesus. Dredge, when Dredge goes busted, it goes real busted. So looks like they're probably not conflagrating this turn. Oh my god, 2 Creeping Chills. We might just be dead now if they have a land. We can block 2 things, which means we take 7 combat damage, and then yeah, conflagrate for 5 exactly is lethal. Hopefully they don't have a land, I guess, or don't see it. Yeah, they even get a blood gas back. Yeah, that, wow. Whew. All right, well, we were never really competitive in this game. Despite having like a pretty good draw on the play, that was something else. So sideboarding, definitely want Spell Pierce, definitely want Rest in Peace, and I think we want Etch Champion as well. I don't think we actually want Dispatch. Frenzy seems way too slow, as does Galvanic Blast. I think we probably don't want any of those. I guess we could have one Dispatch in our deck, or one Galvanic Blast. Those are the options. Yeah, Dispatch probably a little bit better. All right, let's hope that we have some disruption, because that was explosive. All right, here we are for game two. We get to go first. I think this is a keep. I guess we don't actually have a turn one disruptive card. Yeah, this still has to be a keep. We can go turn one drum. Can't actually play the Spell Pierce on turn one, but we can go turn one drum Opal. And then hopefully Spell Pierce their turn two play. It'd be great if we drew a land, because then we'd get to go Signal Pest. We get to go... Okay, that's good, too. That plays as well. Yeah, now we can go Overseer. Leave up Spell Pierce. Not going to play the Signal Pest. I think getting to Spell Pierce, like a Cathartic Reunion or whatever, is going to be too valuable. And it looks like that is exactly what we're going to get to do. Sweet. All right, well, being on the play makes a world of difference, and also having a disruptive card, of course. So now we'll go Ornithopter, Pest, activate Overseer, play a Plating, get our whole hand out there, hope that things don't go too badly. Ancient Grudge would be pretty good. They get to kill Overseer and Plating, and then we only have 5 power left. But what can you do? Looks like they're getting back a Narcomoeba off of their draw step. Is this going to just be a hard cast Stinkweed Imp? That seems pretty beatable. So we actually have double black. So I think we just attack with the three creatures and then send over that Cranial Plating wherever we need it. Do that and do that. That's a boatload of damage. All right, there's one Creeping Chill. But our opponent is still committed to just spending all of their mana recasting Stinkweed Imps this turn, which is pretty nice. And now they have to block both of our Ornithopters. Actually, they're just dead, right? Yeah, they can only block two things, and we have three lethal-size attackers. I suppose they could have Nature's Claim, which would be moderately annoying. looks like that's very likely what's happening. No, not at all. All right, nice. So we got that one. Yeah, Dispatch actually seemed like it would have been pretty good in that game. I think Etch Champion is still going to be good because just getting through blockers is nice. Signal Pass might just be bad against Memnite. Maybe we should cut it. That seems reasonable. Cut a Signal Pass for a Dispatch. All right, let's give this a try. All right, here we are for game three. We're on the draw, and unfortunately, we don't get to keep this hand. And also, I'm just noticing we have mismatched Springleaf Drums. That's pretty embarrassing. Sorry about that. Obviously, would love to keep any hand with Rest in Peace, but this one will not cut it, unfortunately. Opponent also joining us in the mulligan. This hand is fine. It's not great. Ornithopter on top. I mean, that does make our Overseer better, but I think we can do better. We have artifacts, so all of our sideboard cards are online. And the worst thing we can draw is really a 2 or a 3 drop. So I think shipping that one back is probably for the best. All right, Faithless Looting discards Loam. I'm going to represent Spell Pierce, I guess, just because we got him so good with it last game. So they didn't have anything too explosive to discard. Hopefully they don't have a Cathartic Reunion as well. Oh, they didn't even dredge Loam, so they must not have the second land yet. That could lead to some awkward things. Okay, or they don't have a second green source, so they didn't want to get back Loam that they couldn't use. This looks like a potentially a Conflagrate for zero coming in here. If my read is correct, no, they're not going to do that. All right, well, Steel Overseer it is. They can Conflagrate it. Hopefully no Dark Blast. That would be the worst. All right, no Dark Blast. Dredged Loam into a Narcomoeba, which is going to get back that Prized Amalgam, but not a lot else going on. And I think they still don't have a green source? Yeah, okay, so that's good news. I think we just go Ravager Signal Pest here and go ahead and use Steel Overseer now again to play around if they, you know, take a natural draw step, which I think they're going to have to do to be able to win this game. Okay, double Creeping Chill, and they hit a Conflagrate so they can bin 5 to do 5, but we get to save basically 2 things because we get to use Ravager and also Welding Jar. And we might be able to set up an Ink Moth kill here, potentially, depending on what exactly our opponent has. Because, yeah, if they don't, we're going to have the Ravager and the Overseer left over, I think, after this is all over. They're going for 2 and 2, and 1 here. All right, well, I'll sack Signal Pest and jar that. Our opponent has no cards left. So we have 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So we have to draw. Okay, that doesn't do it, right? Because we get 4 from the 2 ink moth, and then the Ravager is worth 5 because it can eat the Overseer. So that's only 9 total. So I think that means the best course of action is to try to make sure that we don't die next turn. So I think that's just activate Ink Moth with itself, use this, and just hit for 2, and then we have Dispatch available for Narcomoeba. It taps it anyway, actually. Tapping it is as good as killing it at this point, because the game's not going to last that much longer. So they're going to dredge. They hit a Narcomoeba and a Creeping Chill. Kind of annoying, but we still have... Yeah, we can still just block Prized Amalgam. And then, yeah, we'll end of turn tap a Narcomoeba, and then attack with both, and that is still lethal. And they do get another Prized Amalgam back. All right, well, I feel like we kind of stole this one, because our draw wasn't that good, but it was good enough. This is plenty. All right, there we go. 4-0. We'll be back for an exciting round 5 after this.
Hey everyone, I'm Luis Cotburgis, and I'm actually one of the lead designers on Eternal. Eternal is a digital card game that I've worked on since the beginning, and it's both fast-paced and very deep strategy. It's free to play. You can play it on Xbox, you can play it on Steam, you can play it on iOS, so it's easy to pick up and you can play whenever you want. I've had a lot of fun with it, and I think you will too.
All right, here we are for round number 5 on the draw, and unfortunately I believe this is a mulligan. Mox Opal is busted, but that doesn't mean you want to draw 3. All right, this looks better. This looks pretty good, actually. Do we want to leave Blink Moth on top? Yeah, I think we actually do. We're going to have 4 mana on turn 2, so we can cast... Well, we can either cast turn 2 Plating or turn 2 Frenzy. We'll see. So we're up against a KCI strategy. I wonder which gives us a higher chance of killing on turn 3, or turn 4. It seems pretty unlikely we're going to kill on turn 3 here with what we have. So if we play Plating, equip attack. I think we should just play the Plating probably. It is an awful lot of damage. This does leave us a little bit vulnerable to engineered explosives, but, you know, good beats if that's how this is going down. Hopefully we don't just die here. Obviously it is possible. Looks less likely now that they chose to cycle through a sphere and a star. Just makes it a lot less likely that they have the goods. Looks like they're probably missing a land drop, would be my guess. And it's not going to take too many hits from our good friend the Vault Scourge here to close this game out, I think. So, you know, if they miss one more turn, I think we should be able to get something going. Oh, no, they did have a land. Okay, so they're just missing the KCI then, probably. Well, now we are super dead if they have it on the next turn, assuming we don't, you know, draw another Plating or something. Because they have... They just have a lot of goods. So we can hit for 8 with the Vault Scourge and then use Galvanic Blast. So they cracked Mind Stone right away, which is interesting. That means they only have 4 mana. They actually are kind of tight on resources now. If they had all this stuff in play, then they would get to play KCI with Inventor's Fair still untapped, but now they're not going to be able to do that, and they have access to less mana if they do play KCI. And their Mox Upple's not even online, actually, so they don't even have that at all. So I guess we should just hit for 8 here and not even bother with the Frenzy. I think I like that best. Galvanic Blast does, you know, a little bit of disruptive work for us, potentially. Let's see what they can get up to. EE still slightly problematic for us, for sure. Although I guess we're still just like a Nexus away from killing through it. Okay. Definitely decreases the likelihood. Stirrings means they can't EE this turn. Right? They can't even, unless they have like another opal that they're willing to spend, which again is going to leave our opponent very, very low on resources, because what they would have to do is sack Chromatic Star for a green or a blue or whatever, use Grove. Yeah, I actually don't even see how they could play and activate EE this turn. It seems not possible. Okay. Nice. All right, well, we didn't have the fastest clock in the world, but it was good enough. So, sideboarding. I think these 8 are all good. Frenzy does not seem like where we want to be, because we're likely to end up with some amount of this stuff in our hand. This might also be too much. I don't know if we actually want all of this artifact destruction nonsense, or if we want to just not bring in Wear Tear. I think that's what I'm going to do, actually, is not bring in Wear Tear, and I'm going to cut some Galvanic Blasts. Actually, I think I should leave in Galvanic Blast because of Psy. Psy seems like it could be really problematic for us. So for other cuts, I think Signal Pest is fine to remove. So we're plus one non-artifact from where we started, I think. Is that right? No, it must be plus 2. We had 4 blasts, yeah. So we cut 1 blast and 3 frenzy and 2 signal pests. So the 2 signal pests were the 2 non-artifacts. And I think Galvanic Blast is better than Dispatch, although Dispatch does hit Trawler a little better. I think them blocking on the ground is not that big of a deal, so that doesn't actually seem like it probably matters all that much. Yeah, I think this looks good, and I'll give it a try. All right, here we are for game 2. With a pretty mediocre looking hand, I think this is probably a mulligan. We don't have any disruption. We don't have that fast a clock. Yeah, this looks like a mulligan to me. All right, this at least if we draw a land, we can, you know, play turn 2 Steel Overseer, turn 3 Ravager, and maybe try to get something going there. Okay. Oh, I should have played Signal Pest. I was thinking that it doesn't really matter which thing I play, because I want to just maximize damage, and Vault Scourge has a power where Signal Pest doesn't. But because we're going to be playing Steel Overseer, I think limiting our exposure to Engineered Explosives for 2 might actually be a relevant thing that we have to care about this game. So I think I probably should have played the Pest instead for that reason. It's a little awkward. Alright, our opponent took an Ichor Wellspring that they can't cast quite yet. Alright, looks like we're probably getting turn 3'd. They have a lot of card draw available to them because we know they have an Ichor in hand. And this is probably a slight sequencing error by our opponent. Typically when you have... that's very strange then. I think they should have sacked the Opal to play the Trawler, because then they could sack the Star for 2 mana and have... and get the Opal back. So they lost out on a bit of mana. Although they're going to have so much mana that it probably doesn't matter. So I'm gonna let them go for a bit. But I am going to concede if our opponent has, you know, a loop or something very close to a loop. Like, if they play another Scrap Trawler at any point here, basically, I'm going to let it go. Yeah, that'll do it. They're going to get back Ichor and Terrarian. Maybe they're not 100%. They're very likely, though. They have at least 4 additional draws. But maybe they've diluted their deck a little bit with Nature's Claims and such. Yeah, I'll let it ride for a tiny bit longer. We know they have one more one. If they play another Scrap Trawler, I'm for sure dead, so I'll concede to that. But I'll let this go a tiny bit more. In general, I feel like people should concede more often than they do on Magic Online. I understand that it's your right to run out your opponent's clock, but it's also usually in your best interest to not waste a bunch of your own time. Like, I get that you could make a sandwich or whatever, but if you wanted to do that, just don't play Magic. Go make a sandwich. You know, I think in general people are a little too hard-nosed on not conceding. Okay, Psy beats us anyway. We can't actually get through Psy with all this stuff that they're going to have, so I'm good tagging out here. We'll get them in game 3. Do we want to change our sideboarding at all? I think probably not. It does actually kind of make sense to me that Vault Scourge might be worse than Signal Pest because of Engineered Explosives for 2 being so effective, and we want to limit our exposure to that. I don't know if that's crazy, but I'm going to go with it and give this a try. I think still only 3 Galvanic Blasts is probably right, even though Psy is going to be problematic. I think we just have to suck that up. So yeah, let's give this a try. Alright, here we are for game 3. We get to go first. This hand looks fantastic. We have Spell Pierce and Rest in Peace. Although Rest in Peace Ravager, not a combo. You gotta watch out for that. Don't want to trick yourself. Our opponent is on the mull to 6. I think I will actually Spell Pierce this here. We're pretty vulnerable to EE for 2, which is the other spot that I think Spell Pierce could be high leverage. Oh, well, now I get to play everything. I'm going to play Ravager, sack this Opal, play Rest in Peace, and hopefully this is disruptive enough. This does actually leave us pretty vulnerable to Nature's Claim as well, I suppose, because they can just kill our Ravager and then we have no pressure. But we will see. Yeah, I mostly used that Spell Pierce there because I thought there was a chance we wouldn't get another good chance to Spell Pierce in this game. That might have been too aggressive. Not sure. Okay, Galvanic Blast is pretty bad draw. I think I'm going to go ahead and eat one Citadel. It makes Cranial Plating a worse draw, but I think increasing the clock is more important than that. I want to close this game out quickly before anything too bad happens to us. Okay, Ichor Wellspring, not a big deal. And I'm going to save Galvanic Blast still. Might end up using it. Springleaf Drum will definitely be fed to the Ravager. And then we hit for 5 this turn. Then 6 plus the Galvanic Blast is lethal next turn. So we easily have lethal next turn. Nature's Claim is going to hit Rest in Peace. Sure. So now Ravager's back online. Don't know if that's going to matter. Does also mean that they can cantrip off a little bit. Stirrings, that is fine. That's dirtily enough that I don't really care. Inventor's Fair, sure. So our opponent is going to need something in the way of blocking to survive here. We're just going to kill him. Of course, they don't know that. They don't know we have a Galvanic Blast. Boom. Upstairs. And that'll do it. All right. 5-0. So that was pretty impressive. It looked like the... Frenzy was a good addition to the deck. Like game one of match one, we went off pretty hard with it. We had a couple other games where we got to play it and have it be pretty effective. Definitely seemed better than Thoughtcast to me, and this deck looked like it might have some legs. So thanks for watching, guys, and we'll be back next week.